Justin, I can't hear you. I think you're muted. There should be an unmute button down. Hold on, Justin. I need to let you go. My student's here. We can continue this later. Bye. Sorry about that. Justin has a lot to learn about video conferencing software. Maybe I should have had him stay so I could teach him at the same time I'm teaching you. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to participate in virtual meetings using video conferencing software. Let's get into it. Video conferencing software has been around for a while, but it really became popular at the height of the COVID shutdowns. People were video conferencing with teachers, doctors, coworkers, and of course, friends. It ended up working so well, in fact, that many of those uses stuck around even after the lockdowns went away. Some people just prefer being able to meet with anybody in the world from the comfort of their own home. In order to use video conferencing, you'll have to do a few things. First, check to see which platform the person setting up the meeting wants to use. There are a lot of different video conferencing platforms out there, and you don't want to realize too late that you're using the wrong one. Next, you'll need to sign up for an account with that video conferencing platform. Luckily, all of the most widely used platforms are either completely free or offer free accounts with few limitations. And before you ask, yes, this is one of those things for which you have to have an email address. See? Told you it was important. Finally, some platforms do allow you to join meetings from a web browser, but the features that are available to you in the browser version are way more limited. If you want to get the most out of video conferencing, you might need to download and install the full video conferencing software onto your computer. Luckily, the option to download the necessary software is found right there on the platform's website. Just make sure to get permission from a trusted adult before downloading or installing any new software to any device. Once you've checked what platform the other person wants to use, made an account with that platform, and downloaded any necessary software, you're ready to chat. The way video conferencing works is that one person, usually the person leading the meeting, hosts the meeting in a virtual meeting room, just like somebody might host a party in their home. Then everybody else joins that meeting room as a participant. If you're joining somebody else's meeting room, they will provide you with either a room ID or a link. With a room ID, when you open the video conferencing program and choose Join, you'll be prompted to enter the ID. Some rooms might be locked behind a password to prevent uninvited intruders. The host should have provided that along with the meeting ID. If the host sent you a link, joining is even easier. Just follow the link. Depending on your browser settings, you may need to tell your pop-up blocker to let a new window open. Luckily, most browsers will give you a notification, so all you have to do is click yes. If you're the host, it will be your responsibility to send out the room ID or the link. If you're starting the meeting right then, there's usually an option somewhere in the meeting window to invite new people. You'll find the room ID and link in that invite. If you're scheduling a meeting for later, you can type in the participants' email addresses and send them an automatic invite with all the necessary information. The invite will also be available in the video conferencing program once you finish scheduling the meeting, so you can copy it into an email or text and send it to whoever you want. Now that Justin has joined us, let's learn how to use all these features together. Justin, did you mute yourself again? How? All right, I guess that will be the first thing we learn. That icon that looks like a microphone is the mute button. Justin's already pressed it, and that's why we can't hear him. His mute button probably has a slash through it like this. Right, Justin? Thought so. That's how you know you're muted. To unmute yourself, just press that button again.
Now can you hear me?
Yes! Okay, I'm glad we got that figured out.
What does this button next to mute do?
Well, that should be pretty obvious now. It's the camera off button.
Yeah, I see that now. But aren't the cameras kind of the whole point of video conferencing?
Yes, but it's considered polite to turn your camera off if you need to move away from your computer for any reason. When you get back, just press the camera button again to turn it back on.
I'm back. I went and grabbed a snack while my camera was off.
Looks delicious. Justin, can you do me a favor and hit both the mute and camera buttons before you eat that?
Oh!
Justin currently has his microphone and camera turned off, so we don't have to watch or listen to him eating. But even without a camera or mic, participants can still see and hear everyone else, and they can still interact with everyone else in the chat. Sorry, Justin. I've seen you eat before, and it is not a pretty sight. You just enjoy your snack while I finish the rest of this lesson. Since I'm the host, I can use a few extra features. By default, the host is the only participant allowed to screen share. This takes whatever is on the host's computer screen and shows it to everyone in the meeting, a very helpful feature for things like presentations. The host can even allow other participants to screen share if they need to, like this video Justin is sharing of a cat getting a bath. Fair enough. Thanks for sharing that cute video with us. In some video conferencing programs, the host can set up breakout rooms. This splits up all the participants into mini rooms, so multiple separate discussions can all happen at once. Then, when the host wants to, they can pull everyone back into the large room again. Finally, the host can record meetings. This comes in really handy for super important meetings that somebody can't participate in. After the meeting finishes, the host can send the recording to those who missed it, so they can watch the recording and stay in the loop on any important news or decisions.
Hey, sorry to interrupt. I'm learning a lot here, but I do have to go teach my own course now, so how do I leave the...
Oh, no problem. To leave a virtual meeting, you just click that red button down there.
Oh, thank you. See you later, Caroline.
I'll send him the recording later so he can catch up. There's still one important thing we need to learn about. Safety features. Video conferencing software has several built-in safety features to keep you and your fellow participants safe. First, room IDs and links act like keys, keeping out anybody who doesn't have them. Don't share these details with strangers, or you might end up with some shady characters showing up and causing problems in the meeting. This actually happened a lot at the start of COVID lockdowns, especially in virtual classrooms. Even though it happened on every video conferencing app, it eventually became known as Zoom bombing. Like, photo bombing, but on Zoom. Even if they aren't given the exact room ID, some aspiring Zoom bombers just guess IDs until they find a room that matches. But it's almost impossible to guess a correct room ID and a password. So use passwords in all rooms you host to keep Zoom bombers out. You can also enable a waiting room if you're the host. This keeps participants out of the meeting until the host approves or denies them access. This way, if a stranger tries to join, you can kick them out before they even get in. Remember, just having me explain how to use video conferencing software won't help you learn anywhere near as quickly as getting personal experience with it. If you have a long-distance friend or family member, this is a great opportunity to catch up with them and show them what you're learning. Once you've mastered video conferencing software, you'll be ready to move on to the wrap-up for this unit, which will review browsing the web, emailing, and video conferencing before you prove your knowledge on the unit assessment. Then you'll move on to the next unit, which is all about performing research on the internet, how to use search engines efficiently, how to judge whether information is biased or credible, and how to give credit to people whose ideas you use in your own content. Until then, remember, your brain is the smartest computer you'll ever have, so keep it charged and never stop updating it. Hey, hey.